Thank you so much, Sasha and Charles. That was awesome. It's been so amazing to have you guys be part of this online assembly. And I don't know what I'm going to do when it's over and I don't get to hear your voice every Saturday afternoon. For those of you who joined us during the song, that was Sasha and Charles playing Let It Be by the Beatles. And this is the Animal Liberation Online Assembly. So welcome. My name is Joanna and I'm one of the organizers. And I just wanted to thank everyone so much for being here today.
Hi, my name's Aiden. So the session today, really excited. We're going to be kind of turning a bit our attention inwards, talking about our community and sort of reimagining the boundaries of the animal rights community, what that entails, talking about bringing farmers and animal farmers into our movement. But first, let's see just how currently spread out our community is, which is one of the things I love about these calls. So start throwing in the chat where you're joining from, and let's see how international we are today.
Oh no, where's the chat? Oh, there it is.
All right, we got Chicago, Montreal, Pacific Northwest, a lot of Americans. Okay, there's someone from France. There we go.
Someone from
the same house as me. All right, yeah, that's true. Someone downstairs.
England. Nice. Cool. Wow, there's so many places. UK. Yeah. Thank you all so much for being here. And yeah, it's great to see everyone and see so many people joining from faraway places. So just before we jump into the content today, you know, a lot of us have been on these Zoom calls before, but if you haven't, we like to ask folks on the call to rename themselves. So you can include your name in your name, your pronouns, and also, you know, put your location in there, and maybe people can, you know, scroll through and you can maybe meet a new friend who lives near you that you didn't know about before. We also have Spanish captions available today, which you can see by clicking the little CC button at the bottom of the Zoom screen. And we also have ASL interpretation on today's call. Amanda has been our ASL interpreter. Amanda, can you say hello for everyone?
Hi, I'm Amanda. I'll be interpreting. And if you want to pin me the top right corner, there's three little dots. You can click on that. Click on pin video. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Amanda. And just thanks for being on all these calls. Amanda has been our ASL interpreter for the Animal Liberation Online Assembly. And it's been so amazing to just have you be a part of this and help us make these calls accessible to more people. So let's all just give a big round of applause for Amanda.
It's funny to watch Amanda interpret us thanking her for interpreting her. And now she's interpreting that. It goes on forever.
Cool. So if you can turn your video on, you know, it helps us feel a little bit more like we're together today. So you can do that and you know, scroll through the gallery and check out who's all here. And just a reminder, you know, we do uphold the same standards of conduct for online events as we do for in-person events. So anyone violating that will be removed from the call. And also just a quick disclaimer about Zoom. Some folks have experienced online attacks on Zoom where unwelcome visitors join the meeting and usually take over by like sharing graphic videos on the screen or something like that. And this hasn't happened at Aloha, and we're taking extensive precautions to make sure it doesn't, but we just want to let people know that that is a risk, I guess, of joining these calls, and we can't guarantee that that won't happen here. So, you know, obviously we can't gather in person together right now, and we're not sure when we're able to, but we can join these calls and we can find other ways to connect with people. And something that we are planning is we're going to have some after parties in a few cities around the world, because, you know, taking action doesn't always have to mean protesting, as we've learned by joining all of these Saturday calls. It can also just mean coming together and supporting each other and finding ways to connect with like-minded people. So if you're interested in joining one of these after parties, you can go to the link on this slide here. We are not sure when the after parties are going to be yet, or we don't really have much planned for them, but we are going to have them. And so if you want to sign up and just stay informed about the one that's happening close to you, go to the link there. And if there isn't one happening in a city near you, you can sign up on that same form to host one as well. So check out that form, and hopefully we can make some new friends from this online thing when we're able to get offline and hang out again in person. And, you know, we're doing things differently than we did a couple months ago before COVID sort of changed this whole world that we're living in. And so we've been experimenting with different ways to take action online. And one way is we've been doing these weekly social media challenges, social media actions. So before we do today's social media challenge, we're going to hear about what we're going to be doing for the social media challenge, what we're promoting. So we have Lewis here to talk more about that. And yeah, just let's give it up for Lewis. Lewis, take it away.
Sorry, you never make me a co-host after I make you the host. Cool. Okay, so I just want to talk really briefly about what we're promoting and a little bit about where we are as a movement right now. And I think we find ourselves in a really interesting moment in human history, and especially as the animal rights movement. I think as activists and investigators, many of us are probably not particularly surprised to see that yet another zoonotic disease from animal agriculture has caused a global crisis. But I've definitely personally been caught off guard by the actions and protocols that we've taken and that we've been able to take in response. This is a very unprecedented moment for our movement. A national spotlight has been cast on the institution of animal exploitation. And it seems like every day another slaughterhouse is being shut down, a new farm is being exposed for leaving their animals to starve, and there's a fresh take in the New York Times opinion section about how the pandemic is going to end the meat industry. But as much as I appreciate them, we know that op-eds by Jonathan Safran Foer are not going to save the animals suffering in factory farms. As exciting as it is to think that this crisis is creating change for animals, we know that change will not come without action. When slaughterhouses close, animals are suffocated or buried alive unless activists are there to save them. When meat prices drop, or there are shortages, the government props up the industry and keeps the pockets of the billionaires full. And when the press talks about factory farming, they ignore the perspective of the animals. Throughout history, we know that those in power have always silenced the perspective of the oppressed until enough pressure is put on them that they no longer have the choice. We had amazing plans for this year, and especially for this month. At the Animal Liberation Conference, we come together from across the world, and we set a bold, uncompromising tone for the entire movement for the rest of that year. And I wish I could tell you exactly what we hoped to execute this year, but trust me when I say it would have been a game-changing action. But these new circumstances present us with new opportunities, and we need to adapt. We can use this time to train, plan, and prepare ourselves and our communities. We can use our access to online meetings and events to learn new skills, support each other, and embolden our sense of commitment. And we can use this powerful, emerging narrative to expose the system of human supremacy as the unjust, dangerous, and destructive force that we all know it is. Taking direct action, saving lives, and forcing the public to confront reality is what we do, and we will not be stopped. Of course, we need to follow social distancing precautions and be careful about how we go about things, but I think there's still some really exciting stuff that we can do. There are actions that we can take around the world right now that will use this narrative that's emerging in the press every day. There are still animals to be saved. There are still actions to be taken, and we are going to do that next week. So if you believe what I believe, that it's up to us to make this change, I have three opportunities for you to help. First off, go to dxc.io/cdsurvey. And let us know that you're interested in taking direct action. We already have some plans coming up soon, but we want to know who is interested in taking high impact direct action in the future. And we want to make sure that everybody gets the opportunities that they're willing to take. Second, we're doing a training this Tuesday about why civil disobedience works and what it's like to get arrested. And it's being co-facilitated by Rachel Ziegler, who's probably been arrested for animals more than anyone else I know. And it's also being facilitated by myself. And you can RSVP at dxe.io/cvtraining. And I'll put all these links in the chat. And finally, and most exciting, we have some pretty big plans for next week. May 30th is the last day of the Animal Liberation Online Assembly. And as you know, we like to end things with a bit of a splash. So I can't get into the details, but just trust me when I say you will not want to miss it. In the age of coronavirus, online is where everything's happening. That's where the press is. That's where the politicians are. Everybody's on Twitter. So we need as many people as possible on our call to make sure that the press is unable to ignore the actions that are being taken. And we have some ways that we can actually take action online together as well. So, in summary, we need you to sign up, to get trained, and to take action with us next week. Make sure you don't miss next week's Aloha call. So, I will hand it off to Zoe now, I think, to talk about the social media aspect of this. Awesome.
Yep. Thanks so much, Lewis. And what we're actually going to do this week is promote next week's Big Bang to make sure that we have enough people on this call and enough people supporting us that we make as big of a difference as possible. So we're going to go ahead and do this week's social media challenge because obviously we're all stuck at home, but that doesn't mean we can't take actions to make the world a better place for animals and to promote next week's big action. So folks can follow along. To start, folks should go grab a black marker and a flower, fake or real. If you are not comfortable writing on your skin, then you might not need the black marker. But if you are comfortable writing on your skin, then grab a black marker and either way, grab a flower. So I'll give folks like 2 minutes to do that. And while people are doing that, I have some awkward news. I can't actually really participate in this week's challenge because I got all my social media accounts taken down. Bit of a situation. I may have posted some things criticizing a program called Future Farmers of America and 4-H, which are youth programs where kids raise animals for slaughter, and they did not like that. So I got thousands of hate comments and hate mail. And basically they all reported my account, said that I was under the age of 13, but you know, like everybody else, I was once under the age of 13. And unfortunately I did have a Facebook account before I was 13. So I don't know if that's going to be a problem with getting my account back. But anyway, this is just a really long story of saying that I got my accounts taken down. So I actually don't have Instagram or Facebook right now. hopefully I'll get my accounts back soon because I sent them my birth certificate showing that I'm 17. But I'm currently Instagram and Facebookless. But I do have Twitter, so I can do Twitter. Because we all got to remember to use Twitter. Or Matt will be very disappointed in us. Matt leads our press team, and he's a strong proponent of Twitter. He says it's very important for press. I always forget Twitter, but we gotta remember Matt says it's very important. All right, folks, about 30 seconds. Again, you're getting a black marker if you're comfortable writing on your skin, and a flower, fake or real. Four, three, two, one. Cool. So hopefully everybody has a marker and a flower. So now we're going to go to the next step, and you're going to, let's see, it's not going to the next slide. Okay, here we go. Whoops. Okay, So step two, you're going to write liberate on your arm. I wrote liberate. Well, actually, I didn't do it. Somebody else wrote it on my arm because I have horrible handwriting. But write liberate on your arm, kind of just like on your forearm so that you can, you're going to be holding the flower. So you want it to be able to show while you're holding the flower. So go ahead and write liberate on your arm if you're comfortable writing on your skin. If you're not, no worries at all. And you can still participate. Sorry. You can still participate and just hold a flower. So I'll give folks about 2 minutes to write that on your arm. And you can do it fancy or just simple, whatever you're feeling. Brianna always goes above and beyond in these photos. She's on the social media team, so she sent her example photo for the slideshow, so you'll see that in a minute. And hers are always like really, really good. It's like really fancy writing. And last week, I think everyone was probably really intimidated because her bloody hand money photo was just like really good. But that's just Brianna. Us normal folk, we just write liberate on our arms and call it a day. Folks have about 1 more minute to write liberate on your arm. Again, if you're not comfortable writing on your skin, no problem at all. Or if you have tattoos or something and it won't show up, no worries. You can just hold a flower. And again, we're going to be using this to promote the action that's going to be happening 1 week from today, where everyone's going to be coming together to take action for the animals who are not being treated very well in normal life, and especially not right now. You know, in a lot of ways, they've been hit the hardest with coronavirus because they're, you know, being gassed to death and just killed in mass in the most inhumane ways. Not that the normal way method, you know, the standard, more standard methods of killing aren't humane, but because there are so many animals right now that are basically just a liability because they can't afford to feed them, they're being killed in like extra inhumane ways. So it's really sad. Okay, so hopefully everybody's written liberate on their arm. Now we're going to go to step three. And you're going to take a picture holding the flower. Again, you want to basically take it so you're holding the flower. And what you can kind of, if you can, take it so it's almost like you're holding the flower forward as if you're like offering the flower to the animals in a way. So let me show you some examples. This is Cassie's photo. You can see she's holding the flower forward, but you can still read her arm. And then this is Brianna's overly fancy photo that makes us all feel like we're really bad at this because hers looks so much better. So I'll give people 3 minutes to take their photos. And that starts now. So go ahead and take a picture. And then we will all post it together on all our social media platforms. And I'll go through and like everybody's posts because I have another after this, because I do have another Instagram account that for my nonprofit. So I can use that to go look at all your posts and make sure that you all actually posted, because otherwise who's going to keep y'all accountable? Because y'all need to do this. I'm counting on you all to take a picture right now and then post it for the next step. So I am, even though I don't have Instagram and Facebook right now, my accounts got taken down. I'm still keeping an eye on you. I'm still making sure you're participating. I don't know if folks saw, but we just rescued a pig yesterday. I'm just trying to talk so there's not awkward dead silence, but we rescued a pig yesterday at my sanctuary. His name is Napoleon. He was from a FFA student, raised him for slaughter, so Future Farmers of America student, and he was going to be killed in a few weeks, but they were really devastated at the idea of him losing his life. and they couldn't imagine saying goodbye to him in that way. So they actually, when we first started talking to them about possibly saving their pig, they were very pro FFA. They're like, yeah, we don't really want him to die, but like, we support the program. It's just like, we just love this pig, but we don't really, you know, we're not against the raising of animals for slaughter as part of this program. And by the time that they were leaving Napoleon here, yesterday morning, they were like talking about how horrible FFA is and how sad it is that all these animals go to slaughter, and how traumatizing it is for the students. So that was just really amazing to see. And then later in the afternoon yesterday, after they'd gotten back home, they texted us, the family texted us, and they said that they were feeling really emotional, and they never thought that they would care about a pig in that way. And they were just so surprised, and they're so glad that they saved his life. So yeah, that was really cool. And the son, who the kid who raised Napoleon, he signed a contract that he will never participate in the animal portion of Future Farmers of America again. So that's really cool too. And folks have about 20 seconds to finish up taking your pictures. Five, four, three, two, one. Okay. Cool. So now we're all going to make our posts on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And basically say something like this in your caption. I am offering a flower to all of the animals who are suffering on factory farms and facing death in slaughterhouses right now. I send them my love and strength. Join us in confronting the nightmare that is animal agriculture. Join us in offering aid to the victims. Join our mass open rescue online 1 week from today, dxc.io/ALOA. So folks can go, you can copy this word for word if you want to, or you can put it in your own words, add your own twists to it. So everybody can go ahead and do that. I'll give folks about 3 minutes. And again, be sure to put dxc.io/ALOA. That way people can sign up to join the call, because the big goal of this post that we're all making today is that we want everybody to come together 1 week from today so that we can make as big of a difference as possible. We want to make a huge impact. And the reality is that we can't do that without large numbers of people. The more people who join this call, the bigger impact we're going to be able to make, and the more animals we're going to be able to help. So be sure to ask all of your friends to register to join us 1 week from today. Even if they haven't joined any other part of the conference, they can join us 1 week from today and be a part of this as we make history for the animals, and they can support it. And you know, they will actually be making a difference by being here. I know it doesn't necessarily sound like, you know, you're making a big difference by joining a Zoom call, but you really are, because we're all going to be taking action to support the people out on the front lines. So be sure to have all of your friends join. Be sure to join yourself so we can all take action together and stand in solidarity, because we will make a big difference. And folks have about 1 minute here. Again, you can paraphrase this, or if you save time, if you wanna, Johanna just commented the text that I have here. So you can literally copy and paste it if you want to. I don't mind.
I threw the text from your slide into the chat as well, so it's easy to copy and paste for people. And I'm just wondering, Zoe, if we can play the music video while people kind of finish up their posts.
Yeah, that's totally fine. Go ahead. Cool.
Awesome. So yeah, if you want to finish writing your post, you can also share the link to your post in the chat once you're done, and we can all go and like each other's posts. And just while you finish that up, and before we get into the main talk for today, we have a music video featuring a world-renowned animal rights activist and country music star, Simone Reyes. Simone was raised on hip-hop and worked alongside Russell Simmons before shifting gears to focus on her dream and follow her passion, which is country music. And today we're getting a sneak peek at her new music video, which hasn't even been released yet. And the video also kind of holds a special place for our community and maybe even for Zoe, because it was shot at Happy Hen Animal Sanctuary and features one of our non-human friends and one of their residents, Chuckles the Rooster. So this is What I Left Behind by Simone Reyes.
I knew that it'd be tough. When I get where I'm going, I'm sure I'm gonna find I'll be a long time leaving what I left behind. I'll be a long time letting go of his embrace.
I love seeing all the applause on the little gallery view. So Simone is actually here with us on the call today. Simone, are you there?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, first a disclaimer. You can't see it here right now, obviously, because it's like we're playing it on video. But at the end, I give links to where you can get those horns vegan. It was very difficult to shoot there because they did have the horns in the background. But yeah, there's a lot of places where you can get resin ones of them, and they look just like the real thing for people that actually want that. I don't know why they would, but if they did, it's available. So.
Awesome. Thanks so much for being on the call. And yeah, I don't know if there's anything else you wanted to just say.
Yeah, I would say that right now we're, you know, I'm the vice president of social compassion and legislation, and we're dealing with a really interesting time because we obviously can't be visiting with our legislatures. Everything's closed down. A lot of the bills that, unless they have the word COVID-19 on them, they're just getting, you know, pushed back or dropped completely. So it's a hard time to represent the animals right now, but that is why we introduced two bills, one here and one in New York, to close down the wet markets. Because obviously, this pandemic, we think, started in China, but there's no reason to think that one won't start in one of the over 81 wet markets that are currently, along with slaughterhouses in New York, which is, of course, the epicenter of the virus, and even out here in California. There are wet markets everywhere. And I think that getting that message out is super, super important. And as well as, you know, you can follow socialcompassionandlegislation.org to find out ways that you can speak to your legislatures, and hopefully there'll be a way for people to support the bill on like a Zoom type thing, because typically we would fly down there, or there would be buses that would go and stand and you know, give their yes, I support this bill. Because no matter what, my feeling is that whether or not we're able to go there in person, just like every other bill, when there's animal abuse involved, the animal abusers show up in big numbers because we're messing with their money. So I would just encourage everybody, it's really important that we shut these wet markets down. We have an incredible opportunity to do that right now based on the fact that people want to be safe, and they're starting to make the connection that animals and wet markets are where these viruses are starting, and that without a vegan world, we will continuously have to deal with possibly losing our lives to the abuse that we've inflicted on animals. So.
All right. Thanks so much, Simone, for sharing about your work and sharing your music.
Thank you.
So we're going to go on to our sort of feature guest of the day, which is Renee King-Sonnen from Rad Girl Animal Sanctuary. So probably everyone on this call has heard Rad Girl's story, but just for a little recap, Renee married a cattle rancher, and she was transplanted onto a cattle ranch from the suburbs, and, you know, fell in love with the animals at first, and over time just, you know, sort of realized that she couldn't take anymore the contradiction of caring for these animals and then sending them off to be killed. And she convinced her husband, and together they converted their cattle ranch into an animal sanctuary. And recently, over the last couple of years, the sanctuary has started to really expand their work, and now they have a program called the Rancher Advocacy Program, which is seeking to support all kinds of other animal farmers in transitioning to animal-friendly both food production of plants as well as caring for animals. So we're going to hear from Renee about that program and about how we as a movement can make sure that we're not missing these opportunities, turning away animal farmers who, you know, really at the end of the day have a huge amount of ability to influence what our society is going to do, you know, how quickly our society is going to move away from using animals, and how we can really speak with those people, connect with them, empathize with them, and ultimately win them over. So hand it right off to Renee.
Thank you so much, everybody on the Animal Liberation Conference, everyone that made this happen. You guys are amazing. I sit in awe in my 62-year-old self looking at all you young rock stars that are out there to liberate animals. I love this exercise, absolutely. I'm going to put animals on the other one, and I'm going to rock, you know, what Tom did out there. I think it was last year. Everything kind of runs together for me now. But, you know, I just want to start off by having just a moment, y'all, of silence for the animals. 10 seconds. All right, y'all, in that moment, if we can just imagine the suffering that all the animals around the globe had in that 10 seconds, that all over the globe today in animal production, just millions of animals, billions of animals every year suffer needlessly. They not only die, they suffer. They live in horrific ways. And as a former cattle rancher, I never once saw it. I never once put my eyes on their point of view. I was so busy living the life of a rancher's wife, you know, in Texas, enjoying what I only knew how to do in a way that was absolutely not in alignment with who I really am deep inside. I, as well as many other cattle ranchers and animal farmers that just have family farms, we all, everyone that I know, we all love animals and we all participate in the violence that it takes to be in the business of animal farming. I speak to folks like that all the time. You know, the way our story started is I grew up in Texas. I married my husband, Tommy, twice. The second time I moved to the ranch in Texas, in Angleton. And, you know, the first time we were married, he didn't have a cattle ranch. He was working for Dow Chemical. And, you know, whenever we married the second time, he had taken up the baton, if you will, of his ancestors and, you know, and had a little small cattle ranch in the middle of Angleton, Texas. When I moved there, he had 29 cows, 29, 30 cows, something like that. And those cows, for the most part, were what's called Black Angus. They, almost every one of them were solid black. And, you know, I didn't pay attention to them other than that they were just there. You know, my perception as it is today versus the way it was then is daylight and dark. You know, we are conditioned in a society that is programmed to not pay attention to these animals that are great. We see them out there in the pastures. We acknowledge that they're there, but we do not make the connections to them that we make to them as vegans. And when I started living out there, my husband was wanting me to get more and more involved in cattle ranching. And I really, you know, I was okay that he was doing that. In fact, I was proud of the fact that I was married to a cattle rancher. I mean, my goodness, I'm from Texas. I went to the rodeos every year. I participated in all that without even thinking about it. You know, but, you know, I was proud that I was married to a rancher, but I didn't really want to open gates and bale hay and, you know, go out there and feed the cows or give them water. You know, I didn't care about any of that stuff until Tommy came home one day and he said, Renee, there's a fella up the road that has a couple of calves for sale. And I thought maybe you might like to bottle feed them, you know, and he tugged on my heartstrings. And I thought, why not? You know, that sounds really cool. Little babies that need bottle feeding. And so that started the whole thing spiraling down, which eventually bounced right up into Rowdy Girl Sanctuary, because one of those calves is Rowdy Girl. Rowdy Girl came into my life as a little bitty, skinny, scrawny, little beautiful little thing. And I loved her. I got to feed her twice a day. I absolutely loved this girl with all my heart. I got to watch her jump and jump for joy, come at me twice a day wanting her bottle. And something in me began to change. I'm a rancher. I am married to a bona fide rancher, you know, with a heritage that dates back into the 1800s, but something in me started to change. My heartbeat started to get in rhythm and in time with the animals out there in that pasture. I began to see them. I began to not only see them, but feel them. And I wasn't a vegan. I was just having a connection to animals I had never had a connection with before, because I always loved animals, but I never had the opportunity to really feel the heartbeat and the soul of bovine. Bovine is the term for cows. So when I speak and use the word bovine, it's the cows, it's the steer, it's the, you know, the bull calves, it's all of them, you know, it's, that's the bovine. But I had never, ever noticed them. And when I was feeding Rowdy Girl, she was feeding me. And so when I was with her, I would look out into that field, I would look out into the pasture, and I would see all of these black beings, and I began to be able to tell them apart. I began to see that there is Tippy, that there is White Spot. Oh, that there, that's Little Girl. And I began to notice all the nuances in their brow, in their ears. I started paying attention to who they hung out with. And as I started to do that, I began to become part of their society. Because in paying attention to them, they paid attention to me. And so, you know, it became increasingly difficult. I never went vegan because I had a vegan advocate with a sign in front of me or at a protest. I never had a vegan advocate, you know, at an AV, you know, demonstration. Rowdy Girl was my vegan advocate. Rowdy Girl herself is the one that woke me up. And it took several years for me to finally make the connection. And, you know, I went from this to questioning everything. And as I began to question everything, my husband began to get really concerned about me, because I would say things to him like, why don't we eat our own cows? How come, you know, we buy, you know, meat from the store, and yet we send our cows up to the sale barn, and you know, we know where our meat, we know where these cows have been. We see that they're raised on the grass. Yet we spend all this money for farm-raised, you know, grass-fed beef. Why do we do that? And he said, well, Renee, that's, you know, that's a difficult question. I said, well, answer it. You know, I want to know why. And he said, well, because I can't eat animals that I know. That answer caused me to go deep into the world that led me to where I'm at today. Because, you know, I always have been a very spiritual person. I have 630 hours of teacher training in yoga, in Ayurveda, in meditation, and a lot of different, you know, metaphysical studies. And so when I started questioning this aspect of, so we eat meat, but we don't eat our own animals. Where is that disconnect? There's something not right there. And so I began to explore into the world of social media and looking for a more humane way to participate in the violence. I figured, well, you know, if I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do it the most humane way possible. And the most humane way possible is to get, by golly, we're gonna pick one of our animals and we're gonna kill it. Because that's more humane than what we're doing. Now, I know that sounds completely off the chain, stupid, and ridiculous. But in the eyes of where I was at the time, this is all I could see. You know, I was bringing myself to a place where I could eventually be open to the truth, but I couldn't see the truth. And so I told Tommy, I said, all right, you know, if we're going to do this, we're gonna pick one of our animals and we're gonna slaughter it ourselves. I can't continue, you know, being a part of something, Tommy, that, you know, doesn't mix with my principles. And I am a highly principled, you know, woman here. And if we're gonna eat meat, we need to eat one of our own. And I said, which one's it gonna be? And so he and I talked about it, and he decided it was gonna be one of the ones that we call Lucky. We call Lucky today because he's been lucky twice. He was actually Rowdy Girl's firstborn son. And at the end of the day, We didn't slaughter Lucky. That journey led me to where I'm at today. But in the process of considering all of that, I talked to our community. I was bringing people together. We were going to slaughter Lucky. We were going to split the meat. And in the process of doing that, I was exploring humane milk. I was getting my milk from a dairy because y'all, as a cattle rancher, I couldn't stand doing what we were doing anymore. And so I was trying my best to justify it in the most manageable way I could. You know, if I'm going to drink milk and butter and eat butter, eat cheese, then I'm going to get it from the dairy next door down the road. And so I would get these bottles of milk delivered to my house. Molly would be on the top of the bottle, Rachel, whoever, you know, and so I felt so good about drinking the milk out of that bottle because Della's name was on there. I knew who I was drinking from. And it just, this is what led me, y'all, to becoming an animal rights activist. So you never know what it takes for people, right? And in the process of doing this, I started watching these slaughterhouse videos because and here I am married to Tommy, you know, and he's trying to sell cows. He's trying to be a cattle rancher. And I'm in the back room crying my eyes out because I'm watching slaughterhouse videos. And I'm telling my husband, Tommy, something's not right. What we're doing is wrong. We are sending these animals. They're going here. They're going to a cell farm. This is what happens to them. He said, oh, Renee, that's propaganda. That isn't really happening. And, you know, that isn't really true. You know, that's, and so I began to question, well, maybe it's not. Maybe that is propaganda. They're crazy vegans. And so, you know, and so this all started to happen. And then one day, after I cried and cried and cried for a week, I would cry. Tommy would say, Renee, you got to stop watching those videos. They're going to tear you up. I said, I can't stop watching them. And then I stumbled upon Melanie Joy. Her dissertation on carnism totally changed my life. It was on October 31st, 2014. And I saw the story about the family eating the beef stew. They were eating the beef stew, and the lady says, or somebody at the table says, what's the recipe? And the lady of the house says, well, so glad you asked. You start off with the pound of very young golden retriever. I am not sure why the wind in the air was right that day, but when I heard that, immediately something in me just like shook, and I was like, so revolted that I could be eating the chopped up body of a puppy, or I could be eating the chopped up body of my grandmother's butt. I mean, who knew what I was eating when it was chopped up in little pieces in a bowl? And see, I had never looked at it like that before, ever. That night, we went to my mother-in-law's, and it was Halloween. And it was a big party. The family was there, the kids, the aunts, the uncles, the sister-in-law, the brother-in-law, the kids, the costumes, all that. And there's going to be a big block party with a parade. And we walk in, and there's a big family dinner at the table. And my mother-in-law comes out with a big pot of beef stew. And I swear to you, the world stopped for me. All I know is amidst the chaos, I said to her, I can't eat that. And she said, why? I said, because it's got floating, dead, hacked up animal parts in it. And the room got quiet. It got deathly quiet. And every eye was on me. And my sister-in-law said, what did you say? I said, it's got floating, dead, hacked up animal bodies. I can't eat it. And my mother-in-law looked at me, she said, well, Renee, you can pick it out. And I said, no, there is no more picking it out for me. And at that moment, I went vegan. And it was a process. I almost drove myself nuts. And as a result of me going vegan, my husband is now vegan. You know, at first, we were going to get a divorce. The marriage was over. I wouldn't let him sell the cows. I became his worst nightmare. he's still trying to sell the cows, and he's married to a vegan now. And I'm like, I mean, can I call it ball blocking? I don't know. That's what I did. I blocked his ass front and center. I would not let him take the trailer to the cell barn. I said, you take it up the road. I promise you, this is what I will follow you. I will take your credit card. I will buy them cows at that cell barn. I'll bring them all back home. It ain't happening anymore. It's over. Now, I didn't know what I was going to do with that. I had no idea. But with all I knew is I was in a crisis. And so I started searching online for vegans because I knew I had become one. And so I started joining this vegan registry, and I found this woman. Her name is Jeannie. And Jeannie and I became great friends, and she convinced me to start the Vegan Journal of a Rancher's Wife and pour out my story. And in so doing, vegans started signing up, following, you know, and all of a sudden I had so much support. And the next thing you know, I'm having the courage to tell my husband, by golly, if you're going to sell them cows, just sell them to me. And he says, well, what are you going to do with them? And I'm like, well, I'll start a sanctuary. He said, in Texas? I said, well, yep. If Texas must need one, there's not one here, and we must need to do this. He said, Renee, you've lost your mind again. I said, well, you know, it's a good place for me to be right now. You know, whatever I've lost, what I have now is so much better than what I had before. And so, you know, Tommy didn't really think I would do it. He didn't believe it, but he kind of appeased me, you know, and he said, well, Renee, if you think you can buy my cows, go right ahead. I could get 40 or so at them for them at the sale barn. I'll give them to you for 30. And so long story short is in less than 4 months on social media, in a crowdfunding campaign, I'd never done this before in my life. I did it with the support of Kip Anderson and other folks out there that really kind of led the way. Howard Lyman, they helped me. They guided me into this quest. And in less than 4 months, I raised the $36,000 and I bought my husband's cows. And and then a few months later, my husband went vegan. And as a result of a cattle rancher in Texas going vegan, we've gotten organic like conversations that have come at us from all over the world. People wanting to talk to us, well, me directly, about the fact that they have feelings for these animals that they're killing. And I have had conversations that if I had a camera on me 24/7, y'all would, you know, we could, you talk about a documentary if I had it. I mean, I have conversations, like the other day a breeder called me. Because I'm friends with this breeder. Her name is Tara. And Tara's Brahmin that she didn't want to kill. She fell in love with this Brahmin. Y'all might have seen him on my social media. He's beautiful. His name is JD. You know, he's here now. But me and her have this, we're developing this relationship. And she called me the other day on the phone out of the blue. And she said, Renee, she said, I want to ask you something. You're the only person I know I could ask. I said, what's up? She said, how come you don't eat eggs? I said, wow, I am so glad you asked. So needless to say, I got to have that conversation with a breeder. And, and by the time, you know, I was done with that, I don't know if she's eating, you know, chicken periods or not anymore. But I know one thing, she heard from me directly about, you know, what chickens, you know, I said, why in the world would anybody want to eat what comes out of that opening of a chicken? Have you ever watched that happen? Why would anybody want to eat that? And, you know, anyway, these are the kind of conversations I get to have with breeders, with ranchers. And in so doing, the Rancher Advocacy Program was created. It was an evolution of our story. The mission of the Rancher Advocacy Program, for those of you that don't know, is to veganize farmers, their families, the land, and the planet. See, RAP is not just about hoping ranchers change and they keep eating meat. I mean, if ranchers change and they start and they start growing something different, like mushrooms or anything else, if they're still having a chicken fried steak, you know, that's not going to, well, it changes what they're doing, but it isn't changing the fabric of the world, which is what we need, dadgum, right now. We need folks to change right the heck now. And so when the Rancher Advocacy Program started developing, it was real important to me to make sure that in these conversations I was having with these ranchers, that they were veganized. And I say that word because in my conversations with them, I don't mince words. You know, I do not mince words with ranchers, yet they still like me. They don't kick me out. They don't tell me they don't ever want to talk to me again. But I am very honest with them. And the reason why we can have conversations that are civil is because I speak their language, and I don't go right slap dab in the front door. I go in the back door. Because see, I know where they live. I know where cattle ranchers live back here. I know what they're thinking. I know what they're feeling. I know what they want to talk about, what they don't want to talk about. I know what they're feeling. I know where their touch points are. I know where the back off points are. And I know right where they are so that when it's time, I can go in and go, now, wake the F up. So, you know, this is, it's a very interesting, almost like a psychology, you know, it's a psychology speaking to them and getting their attention, because none of them want to harm animals. They don't want to harm animals just for the sake of harming animals. Now, I'm not speaking about feedlots and factory farms. That's a whole nother level. I'm talking about family farms. So anyway, there's one such farm. It's the Barrett Family Farm. And the Barrett Family Farm, I'll just kind of share my screen with y'all so you can see who this farm is, if I can find them. They're right here. This is the Barretts, Jennifer and Rodney Barrett. And they live on a farm in Southwest Arkansas, her and Rodney. They've raised cattle and chicken for the last, you know, 18 years. They were doing what they thought was an honest job. I learned about Jennifer and Rodney through Sean Munson. And Jennifer reached out to the universe with a letter one day. Her husband got sick, I'm right here, in 2011. He was having really bad symptoms. He was having horrible conditions in his stomach, and he had to have a colonoscopy, and it looked pretty grim for him. And she started questioning everything they were doing, because she started landing on what would be better for them for their diet was to start eating plant-based foods. So she started cooking more meals at home, adding more and more vegetables to their diet. And in so doing, she started feeling better. And Rodney's problem went into remission. It was ulcerative colitis. And then in 2016, they did a 3-week plant-based program. It was the Engine 2 diet program. Changed their life. So here she is trying her best to figure out how in the world. Here it is right here, y'all. I fought for a while that I could live with the hypocrisy of it. I thought I could be a vegan that just so happened to raise chickens for a living. Girl, guys, I understand that, okay? And when I heard this and read it, I was like, oh my God, I so totally get it. So she sends this letter out to the universe. And what ended up happening from there? And she got a hold of Kathy Preston. Kathy Preston, you know, got a hold of Sean Munson. Sean Munson gets a hold of me. And then that brought her to us. And the story is long and winding. Yes, it is. But I went out there with Ryuji, Peace by Vegan. And I've been there a few times. Our team was out there just this past couple of days ago because they are converting what was once a cattle ranch and a chicken farm into a mushroom farm as we speak. The funding has happened. This transition is happening. It is unbelievable what's happening in this family's world and our world. And we will show the film, if you don't mind, Aiden, if you can go ahead and bring that film up, I will stop my share. And Aiden, if you can just go ahead and show the film, we'll...
All right, yeah. There. So we will, we've got a 10-minute video for everyone. So just settle in here.
The typical rancher needs to make a product that supports their family and keeps them on the land that they're used to living on.
So in RAP, we're creating these models, we're creating these solutions, and the way we're doing it is with real live farm transitions. The Barrett Family Farm is a chicken farm slash cattle ranch. As we evolve these farms from chicken agriculture, cattle farm, to a mushroom farm, we have a crowdsourced group that work with me to revolutionize these farms.
I'm Jennifer Barrett, and this is my husband, Rodney, and we are here in Wix, Arkansas, where we've lived for 20 years. Up until last September, we were raising chickens here in these chicken houses and raising cattle. We are now vegan and gonna convert our poultry barns into growing mushrooms. Back in December, we were almost out of hay for our cattle. And I reached out to Renee. She told me about the Ranchers Advocacy Program.
Their program has helped us to be able to stay here and take care of these cattle and keep
the lights on.
The lights on. Yeah. Without her, this doesn't happen. They're at the forefront of helping us to be able to transition into this mushroom facility from the poultry business so that the farmers like us can have an easier transition because,
yes,
believe me, it is extremely stressful. We've raised birds from 99 to September 2018. Now we're on a whole lot bigger adventure, really. To start something for the future, it's much more sustainable than what we were doing, and a whole lot better for humanity. When I was with Tyson, the yearly bonuses went out for the CEOs, and one of the CEOs for Tyson got $26.5 million as a bonus. I mean, if you figured how far they've got us pressed under their thumb and everything, they would have took that $26.5 million and spread it between all their growers and stuff for PR purposes. Our average was 5¾ cents per pound is what our average. And you go to Sam's and you see a two-pack of chickens that weigh maybe 5 pounds a piece for fryers that cost $12.
So what kind of bonuses did the farmers get that year?
One year they brought us a ham, a box of chocolates.
Yeah, a box of chocolates. That was
something
awesome.
Like that.
The last time they came out to catch chickens, I was sitting out on the porch when the catch crew came in. And I was just thinking, I bet those guys would so much rather be coming out here to harvest mushrooms than to do this job, than to catch these birds.
They bring a crate into the building. You can see that crate, and then you've got 5 or 6 guys that'll be loading that crate while the loader goes out to get another crate. And when he comes in with that one and sets it down, then he'll pick up the one they just filled up, take it out, get another one, bring it back in, and it's just a back and forth until they clean that whole house out. Each truckload, there'll be about, somewhere between probably 4,500 and 5,000 chickens to the truck.
When I was in high school, the very first batch that they caught, I cried because I just was so upset that I knew they were all going to go be slaughtered.
So I just detached myself from this. So watching this right now is, it's hard. That this was the most hellish situation, a person, a bird, I don't even understand why this even exists or how I ever participated in it.
When we got into the business, you think you're doing something that's helping, or we did, you know, it was part of who we were as farmers. But over time, you know, you go through these changes, you start learning about what's going on around the globe, and things start changing, things happen to you. You know, everybody grows up into the culture that we live in right now, where, you know, we eat animal products and processed foods. That's what's in the grocery stores for the most part. People don't know what they're doing. There was a time whenever Tyson went to the 8-pound chicken, not too far as a crow flies through here. There's some farms over there when the catch crew went in there to catch the chickens. I mean, they'd go in that doorway right there and they would load that box and then they would run outside and vomit because there were so many dead birds piled up in them houses that the growers quit going in there getting. Can you imagine how gross that is? I mean, that is some nasty mess.
Yeah.
And people are eating the chickens that come out of them buildings.
Coming to realize that I'd been taking babies away from their mamas, I think that was probably, that's been the hardest thing. But it's stunning. It's stunning to me that I was like, how did I not see it? How did I not? The last time we took babies to the sale, the mothers were just like waiting,
bawling,
crying, bawling. Babies were crying, bawling. This is all this chaos, which I used to only hear is like, it annoyed me. You know, we're down there working and I'm like, there's what? This. I can't hear you. And that kind of thing. And yeah. Like, but that time I was like, these are mothers crying for their babies. But now, knowing that every baby that's been born here since then gets to stay with its mom, gets to stay with its mother, and the mother gets to keep her baby. I don't want to curse, but I don't know how I ever fucked with that. Back in October, my daughter, she was 8 months pregnant, and we'd already had the baby showers and everything. And she went into labor, and we went to the hospital, and there was no heartbeat, and the baby was gone. And to witness that, to witness my very human daughter's heartbreak because her baby was gone, it shook me, it changed me on a soul level. That is not, humans aren't just the only ones that feel that. You know, I've been around enough animals. I've been around, you know, dogs that have had puppies, cows that have had babies, cows that adopt babies that aren't even theirs, that they have this beautiful, lovely maternal instinct, just like us. And for us to just be taking that
mindless
and thinking that we have some kind of right to meddle with that at all.
And it's not necessary.
It's
totally not necessary.
Yeah.
And it's and that truth is hidden. And it's being hidden every day and covered up so people won't see it.
Mm-hmm.
Based on around money. Anybody that would buy into any part of the animal protein business right now, I think would be plumb foolish. That's a lack of education that needs to be taught.
From our own experience and from knowing other farmers and having bought into this business fully, like put our lives on the line and been in it for 20 years, it does not work.
You're pretty much buying into it.
Indentured servitude.
Pretty much.
Yeah. If someone else was doing this, if I heard of another chicken farmer that was going to convert to mushrooms and give us an option, I would be freaking excited. I'd be like, go, yeah. Figure it out.
We would be best friends.
Yeah. Well, what we're really hoping is that this will give farmers an option, poultry farmers especially, because they're so concentrated in this area. and people don't have another option. Like, we didn't have a way out.
Anybody out there, hopefully, that are intrigued or interested in a different way of farming, that want to transition, we hope to be able to work with those people. We're hoping that our story is going to resonate with some of these other poultry producers that are possibly going through some of the same scenarios that we've been through.
Wow, I am speechless.
Yeah, it takes my breath away every time. Every time it takes my breath away, it makes me cry. I'm putting the video URL right there. So those of you that want to grab it, I just put it on the chat. You know, Mercy for Animals did an outstanding job at producing this. I was supposed to actually be there that week that they were there, but we had gotten flooded out last year, and I was supposed to be there, but we had one more time gotten flooded at Rowdy Girl in Angleton, and I did not want to stop this. And so it happened. And you know, when you can take farmers like Jennifer and Rodney Barrett, and they can be mentored and loved unconditionally and supported. See, I was willing to do whatever it took. I didn't know what the freaking heck I was doing, except I knew this. I was gonna do whatever it took to go the distance with this family as long as they were. And that's the spirit of RAP. The spirit of RAP and how it's different from, you know, any other entities out there that maybe going to transition a farm, which I hope we get into a whole space where people are transitioning farm all over the world. But what RAP is doing is, I don't know how I'm going to do it, except I'll figure it out. And as I figure it out, I'll learn. And we create models. And so what we're doing right now with the Barrett Farm is we're creating a model on how to transition a chicken farm that also was a cattle ranch. We saved 240 cows from going to slaughter. And the way I did that was by going to a foundation that I know and pleading their case. I put it all on paper. I had multiple meetings. I pled their case and we saved their cows. That was over a year ago. And in the process, we had a business plan put together. My associate, Paul Berry, worked with me as a right arm to help me write that business plan. It took us over 9 months. Our team, Jody Rash, Paul, myself, and you know, Greg Lottis and others, there's many on the team, on the RAP Coalition. We worked until we got it done. And the plan has been approved and funded. It's funded. And it's a business plan. It's a plan that the Barretts will have to pay back eventually. This part, they've gotten several hundred thousand dollars of philanthropy, and now they've got a business, and they're becoming an LLC. And what we have to do next is we have to figure out, y'all, what do we do with these cows? Not only their cows, but other farmers that are coming out of the fog, other farmers that are waking up like the Barretts. We have to determine, you can't just transition farms and say, well, you know, go slaughter those animals and get back to me. You know, we have to solve this ethical dilemma. Just like Jennifer said, you know, she was trying to figure out how to be a vegan and be a chicken farmer at the same time. You can't do that. So once a person, a farmer, makes the connection as a vegan, ethically, sending those animals to slaughter would kill them. It would kill their soul. And so RAP is determined to figure out how to get land. Anybody out there that wants to help us figure out how to get land resources set aside for one reason only, so that the humans, us activists, can restore the land the way nature needs the land to be, so that the land can take care of these animals. Then we can take animals that are exiting the food system and we can put them on land that will naturally care for them. Cows don't want to eat sweet feed unless they have to. They want to eat grass. They want to eat trees, shrubs, bushes. They know what to eat if Mother Nature is able to provide that for them. And so, you know, when you, this is one of my biggest hurdles, and I'm saying all this because we've got to figure out still how we're going to take care of these cows long term. I mean, the philanthropy can't go on forever to take care of hundreds and hundreds of cows all over the world, thousands of cows. We've got to figure out how to give them back to the land. And so you guys out there on the Animal Liberation Conference team, anybody that wants to help me figure this out, please let me know. Please jump on our coalition. Help me figure this out. I need that help. And you know, I want to say this. When you have a farmer becoming an animal rights activist like the Barretts, y'all, it's gonna explode. When this farmer tells their story, when they tell their story for the first time, and they're gonna tell their story on our RAP summit. The RAP summit was gonna be in Austin in September 18th through the 20th. But now, because of COVID, the person-to-person conference is canceled, like is so many other conferences. And we're going to have an online summit, most likely the first week of November. We're going to make all those decisions by the end of this month. If any of you want to help me with that, I've never done an online conference, but I am determined to figure it out. So if there's anyone out there that wants to help me with this, We're gonna have a platform to tell the Barrett story. We're gonna have a platform to talk about farmers in transition, other farmers, to talk about the problems because of COVID. So y'all get involved. And also the other thing I wanna make sure I don't leave with is the Agriculture Fairness Alliance is a lobbying group that is writing legislation. They've written legislation that has, been in many offices in Congress. Connie Spence and Laura Reese used the Rancher Advocacy Program as a model. We had many, many months of meetings, and they used our model as the legislation for the At-Risk Farmer and Rancher Diversification Act. I will also put that link on the chat so you can see that legislation. And, you know, I don't know what else I can talk about other than to open this wide up for your questions.
Yeah, so let's go ahead and open it up. We'll take questions in the chat if folks want to start dropping questions in there. I saw one about how, if you know about this, so we've heard a lot in the news about how the COVID situation is affecting sort of industrial CAFOs and a lot of industrial slaughterhouses. I wonder if you know about how it's affecting the cattle industry or the ranching industry.
It's affecting it terribly. You know, I know for a fact that farmers are having to, they call it euthanize their cows. There's no place for them. So if you can't have an auction at a sale barn, you can't sell animals. And so if you can't sell animals, you have animals on your pastures and they're breeding a lot and you're having lots of animals and you gotta do something with them. And if you can't sell them, you know, what are you gonna do? And especially the ones in the feedlots, in the, you know, though I feel so terribly for them. But what I've heard is that farmers are having to, you know, kill their animals. I mean, not all of them. Some of them are able to hold on, but it's not a pretty picture.
Diana is asking what happened in the end with Rowdy Girl.
Well, Rowdy Girl's still here. I'm happy to show y'all pictures if you want to see her of me and Rowdy Girl and me and Houdini, her daughter, which I call my granddaughter. You know, if y'all want to, y'all should subscribe to my newsletter and you get to see, I'm always doing fun stuff about the animals and stories, but Rowdy Girl is a conduit for me. She transmits information to me. She projects and I transmit. I listen to her. There's a real synergy between me and Rowdy Girl. And I began to spend time with her, and in spending time with her, I began to think like her, feel like her. I'm able to, I know this may sound far-fetched, but this is why I'm writing a book right now, y'all. I'm actually writing a book all about the fact that me and Rowdy Girl are like twins. The reason I exist right now on this planet today is because of the message that Rowdy Girl transmitted to me. And I feel responsible to project that message into the world. So yes, Rowdy Girl is very much alive, both of us.
Awesome, great to hear. Folks, there's this kind of two similar questions. I'll keep them separate. One is about what can activists in groups like DXE do to support this work and support farmers doing transitions?
Yeah, that's a great question. And, you know, like I said earlier, I would love for y'all to get involved in helping me figure out the problem with the land. Y'all are the future. You know, I need young minds to come in here. You know, there's ways to do this through land grants, through land trust. There's ways to get land, you know, donated for specific purposes. And we can do this. It just takes a lot of people banding together to figure that out. But you can help there. You can help, help me organize the RAP Summit coming up. I know nothing about online conferences. I'm going to do it, but I need help. As far as how you can help farmers and ranchers directly, you know, this is the part that, you know, I really hope to have a program eventually. I will have a program to teach people how to do this, like to actually work out through scripts, conversations that I have with ranchers, because it's really in knowing how to have that conversation. Having been a former cattle rancher myself, I know the language. And so because I know the language, I'm able to have those conversations. But if I didn't know that language, I would be pissed off. You know, I would easily be offended. I would easily want to tell them, you know, you don't know what you're talking about. But I can live in both worlds when I'm with them. And so what I would ask you guys is to suspend judgment. And if you ever are with a cattle rancher or an animal farmer and you need help, just direct message me, call me. I'm very available. I'm probably more available than most of you would ever realize, because this is my life work.
Okay, and the other side of that question is for folks in other countries. So I see people in both Canada and Israel asking, like, what would you suggest how to get something like this going in other countries, or, you know, how to start this up in a country where nothing's happening yet?
Yeah, and I appreciate that question so much. And I'm so honored when people from other countries reach out and want to know how they can bring RAP to their country. We are planning to have those conversations in the RAP Summit. You know, there's an organization called Refarmed. That's REF like Frank, ARM like Mary, D. The founder is Geraldine Stark. She lives in Spain, and she's from France. She's got a farm transition program. It's very interesting. We are very much in collaboration, and she's having farmers commit to not killing their animals anymore if they will make plant-based milk. And what she's doing is she's going into the countryside and finding out who's growing soybeans, hemp, or whatever. She does all this research for them, and then she creates a way for them to get the distribution for this, for whatever that is, to make the milk. And then the farmer makes the milk, and then she helps them get a supply chain in her community, in their community, so that they can have milk drop-off. So, you know, there's folks getting creative. And if you want to just stay plugged in, subscribe to our newsletter on Rowdy Girl Sanctuary. We will be talking more and more about this. The online summit that we're going to be doing in November is going to delve more into how folks can get involved internationally as well, and you know what we all need to do to bring that picture together.
So Almira is asking, you may mention the difference between family farms and factory farms for this program, and asking, you know, do you see this approach working for transitioning, you know, factory farms, maybe more corporate-owned farms? I'm not sure exactly what distinction is there, but.
No, I understand the difference completely. There's a big difference, and it's a great question. This is where, you know, I met a guy when we were, we've been flooded three times. You know, we were like climate change refugees for years, and we finally moved here to Welder. During one of the times that we flooded, the folks that help us are cowboys, cattle ranchers. And get this, one of the guys that helped us move our animals had a feedlot. He came to help us. And I had a conversation with this man. Like I said, if I had a camera following me around all the time, he'd just be crazy amazed at the conversations I have with people that we normally would not mix with. I'm talking to this guy that has a feedlot, and I'm like, really? And I was like, he said, yeah, you know, and he loves animals. The system is so broken. I was on a conference this morning. We were on a conference, you know, the movie Prayer for Compassion, Thomas Jackson did. I was on that panel this morning, and we were talking about this very subject, because the whole idea of war 10,000 years ago, there, before animal agriculture, there was no war. The very meaning of the word war in Sanskrit is the desire for more cattle. So when you stop and consider that factory farms, feedlots, all of these factory corporate conglomerates are a result of a system that's broken. FFA, 4-H, broken. We are in a system that has to end. How's it different? The corporation makes it very different. The corporate structure makes it very different. But the people that are owning stock in these feedlots are, for the most part, family farmers. See, but the corporate structure is what makes it different. So I think if we can veganize the farmers, we can veganize their families. Because, see, right now, family farmers that have kids, you know, these kids don't want to inherit the cruelty. So many of the kids are going vegan, vegetarian. They don't want to inherit the farm. I've had conversations with 8th-generation cattle ranchers about this. They don't know what they're going to do. So I think if we can hit the family, we can break the system, and so that a new system can happen. I don't know that we can just convert, Almira. I know this was a long answer, but it's very complicated. I don't know if we could actually convert the factory farm without converting the family. This is a question for me, you know?
I think that's a great, I like that. John is asking if you have heard about or talked with any any lawmakers or public officials who have interest in using public funds to do any of this kind of transition work or support like animal sanctuaries?
Yeah, well, there's, you know, the lobbyist, Billy Delaney, I think is his last name. He's a lobbyist for Network for Good, and he's a recent vegan. And he's our lobbyist with the Agriculture Fairness Alliance. And he went vegan as a process of this legislation happening. It was so weird. So now we have a vegan lobbyist in Congress. And that is through the Agriculture Fairness Alliance. If you go to their website, if you can look it up, Aiden, it's agriculturefairnessalliance.org, and you can see the legislation, and just put that in the chat, because there's a way for you to go and sign this document and get it to your senators, to your Congress, so that you can start making demands that the subsidies be diverted from animal agriculture to plant-based farming. And that would be a big, big help. Yeah, so we are, you know, we are in the thick of that. Senator Booker has seen this legislation.
Here's a quick question. How many farmers have started the process through the Rancher Advocacy Program?
Currently, we have 3 that are like actively involved in our program. But like there was a farmer I was talking to in North Carolina recently that was thinking about transitioning, and he's decided since COVID not to. You know, we've got some folks that have wanted to transition, but you know, I'm not interested in just changing the farm to a plant-based farm. I'm interested in veganizing the farmer. And so if they want to engage our program, they have to be willing to engage in this process. Like, for instance, Cindy and Richard Traylor in Huntsville, Texas, she is now vegan, the wife, and the husband is a total transitioning vegan. He is so on his way. And he's like a 7th generation cattle ranch in Texas. And so, you know, we have those 3 farms, and that's a big job. You know, transitioning one farm is a big job. And the way I see this happening, is the more stories we can tell, like the Barretts. And just so you know, Star Love Ranch in Giddings, Texas, their story is going to come out on Monday. So on Monday, Mercy for Animals is launching Star Love's story with the Rancher Advocacy Program. So y'all look for that. It's coming on Monday.
All right, and the last question for us right now, Tara is asking if you really think it's possible that Americans will ever fully give up meat.
I do. I absolutely do. Because let me tell you what I believe in. I believe that the superpower of humans is our compassion. I believe that everyone is born vegan, that at our very core, we're vegan. We are taught a system of violence. It is in no way at all appropriate for our species to be violent this way. It is immoral. Animal agriculture is immoral. And I believe that what we're seeing now with COVID is that more and more corporations, more media, more voices are pointing to animal agriculture is immoral. It's ethically wrong. And so I do believe it. The belief is what will make it so. I hope every one of you will believe it and adhere to that and keep doing the amazing work that all of you guys are doing with DXC and the Animal Liberation Conference. Because you guys are rock stars. I love you guys so, so much.
Thank you so much, Renee. And yeah, just a huge thanks for being here and sharing your story. You're just such an amazing speaker, and it was just so wonderful to hear your transition and hear about the Barretts and that video. I know the chat was just blowing up when that was playing, because it was just really touching so many people. So, you know, I think probably most of us here on the call are here because we care about animals. And I think this, you know, I've just been thinking today about even people, those people who don't, who we feel like we might never win over, like hearing some of these farmer stories, like if people don't care about animals, just hearing how this industry is affecting other humans too, I think that's a huge part of this. So yeah, just thank you so much for the work that you're doing, and for being there to show compassion to these farmers. I know it's really easy when we do this work to kind of see farmers as enemies and to kind of villainize them. And I think, yeah, it's just really important that we remember that, you know, farmers are part of, they have to be part of this community. They're part of this world, and they're kind of the key to help us get out of this mess. So yeah, it's been really wonderful having you here today.
Well, thank you so much. And if you guys, you know, ever want to support our work, the best way you can do that these days is by, you know, becoming a member. And we recently, since COVID, you know, lowered the membership to, you know, you can join for $5 a month. I mean, every little bit helps. And really, it's about the numbers of people that join us. It's just knowing that we have your support. We love you guys, so, so much. Thank you so much for inviting me to be part of your program here. And anytime I can help you guys with anything at all, just let me know. I'm always available.
Thanks so much, Renee. And as someone who's obviously a big fan of events, I'm really excited to see your summit in November. And hopefully many of us will be there too. All right. Well, yeah, thanks again. And I'm just feeling so, I feel like this new sense of, I don't even know, like inspiration or hope or something. Very emotional. So, yeah.
Rowdy Girl has done her job. Rowdy Girl's out there making sure that whatever I say is effective. So good. I'm glad it worked.
Thanks so much. So before we jump off for today, we're going to close with kind of an exercise, something a little different than what we've been doing. And, you know, I think a lot of us, we all know and hear about self-care and how self-care is this thing that's important. And, you know, self-care is super important to keep us going. And it's also something that we can do maybe in a moment like this for me, where I'm feeling really emotional and not even sure how to express my feelings. It's, you know, it's a thing that we can do to kind of ground ourselves. And when self-care can also be a way to develop like personal skills or just any skills in general, you know, that's really great. And writing can be a form of self-care. It can also be a form of activism, and it can be a way to just find your own clarity on what your thoughts are and find a better way to express and articulate yourself. So here to lead us through this next exercise is someone who is an activist and is also a writer and a teacher and now a published author. Brittany Michelson has an MFA in creative nonfiction, and she teaches writing and activism related classes in a private K-8 program. And her writings appear in multiple journals and literary sites. And her first book, Voices for Animal Liberation, was published in March. So she's joining us today from Los Angeles. Please welcome Brittany Michelson.
Thanks so much, Joanna. And thank you for the opportunity to be here. Thank you to everybody for staying on the call. I'm going to be talking about the powerful form of activism that is writing. And I'll be sharing some examples of writing in the animal rights movement, and then we'll be doing a writing exercise. So I believe that all angles are needed in our movement. We need all mediums and all angles to get our message out there, to impact the public, and to bring people's attention to the importance, the necessity of animal liberation. So this involves films such as documentaries, visual art, music, and writing, articles and books. And if we can learn how to use writing as a tool in our activist toolbox, it's a very powerful thing. Even social media posts are a way that many of us use writing on almost a daily basis. We use social media posts frequently to get the message out there. So it could be a detailed, heartfelt Facebook post, or a simple tweet, or a powerful image with a caption on Instagram. Those are easy ways that we can use the written word to get our message out there. So this idea of using writing as a means of activism, I'm very interested in the power of personal narrative. I believe that personal experiences can really impact people and help to change hearts and minds for whatever cause anybody is focused on. And we can utilize that in the animal rights movement. So I'm going to share my screen and I will show you some examples of using writing to our benefit for animal rights. Okay, so my interest in using writing as a form of activism led me to put together a book, my first book, which Joanna mentioned the title. It is Voices for Animal Liberation, Inspirational Accounts by Animal Rights Activists. And it's right here. And it was just released at the beginning of March. And it's an anthology of stories and personal essays written by animal rights activists. It's a collection of diverse voices from the animal rights movement. If you're not already familiar with the book, it is available to order on multiple sites. If you just Google the title, you can find different options of where to order it. I really believe that the powerful stories in this book can make an impact in our movement and help change hearts and minds for the animals. So if you already have a copy, you might want to share the book with people in your family and friends, people that are not a part of the animal rights movement already, because I do believe that this will impact people. And hopefully, you know, non-vegans and people who are not activists will also be purchasing the book, and it can really make a difference in their lives. So I'm going to show some articles that are online that have been published. This one is very recent, just a couple of days ago. I'm sure most of you have seen it in the New York Times. If you'll check out the titles, you can see the variety and the range in which writing can be utilized in our movement. So this one is in The Intercept. And this one in Vox. This is an article that I wrote for Elephant Journal, and it was published in late March. Now I'm going to show you some examples from my book. So these are stories that are part of Voices for Animal Liberation, my anthology. This piece by Danny Rukin. So now you can see the more personal side of writing. We looked at articles that are in news outlets and that can be found on the internet. And now we're looking at the more personal side of writing. Here is one by Gwenna Hunter. Here's one by Zoe Rosenberg. And Wayne Shung. All right, so you can see the variety, and really all of us can write in some way. Like I said earlier, even if it's just a social media post, we all utilize the written word in various capacities and can use it to our benefit. So while I was looking into this idea of writing as a form of activism, I was doing some inquiry online. I came across this article, and I just want to share a few passages that I highlighted from it. And the title of it is actually called Writing as Activism. That's the title. I'll pull it up on the screen here so that you can look at it, and then I'll just read a few passages that I highlighted because it perfectly encapsulates this idea of writing as a form of activism. And that is the name of the article. It is by Jesenia N. Class and Robert Miranda in the Harvard Crimson. When we think of activism, writing, perhaps a blog post or a tweet, is not the first thing that comes to mind. Activism seems to invoke something more bodily. Picketing, marching, signs thrust in the air for hours, yelling into a bullhorn until your voice is hoarse, your point hopefully communicated. A collection of words strung together on a page doesn't carry quite the same tune as a protest chant. Yet there is something to be said about the momentum of the written word. It can be a powerful thing in the activist's toolbox. Not always appreciated is the ability to have a universal audience at one's fingertips, to have the ability to share one's voice precisely and thoughtfully, or advocate for a particular reform. This is powerful. Writing in its many forms, journalism, novels, reports, reviews, social media blurbs, is necessarily contingent on this strong belief in change. And activism, a series of demonstrations of one's desire for social reform, reflects this change. The act of writing, as author Margaret Atwood put it, imagines a future reader, thus imagining a future, one that could be influenced by said writing. And as author Nadine Gordimer put it, writing is one's unique contribution to social change. As a vessel for communicating one's idea, it's difficult to imagine a form of writing that doesn't have roots in change. So, like I said, it perfectly encapsulates this idea of using writing as a tool to get our message out there and to impact the public, whether it's a personal experience that you're writing about or an informational, factual piece, such as an article. And you know, we don't even have to think in terms of that all the writing needs to be published. You could do a piece of writing for a blog. Blog posts are very powerful. You could even write a piece and then send it out in an email blast to everybody in your email list. You just never know how your words will impact certain people and you know the way that your message can come across if you experiment with it and give it a try. So now we're going to segue into the writing exercise. And I just want to emphasize the idea, the notion that really anybody can write, anybody can put words to paper and see what transpires. So we're going to do a free writing exercise. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to share a document that has options that I am going to give you for the free writing exercise. I just want to say a few things about free writing before we begin. So I teach writing to kids. And a lot of times students will come into class nervous about writing, or they're not sure that they can express themselves clearly, they're not sure how to write, or they feel that it needs to fit into a certain structure. So we do this exercise called free writing, which is all about opening yourself to any thoughts and ideas that come to mind and simply letting them onto the page. And I know it sounds simple or elementary, but anybody at any age can utilize this writing exercise to stimulate ideas. It's sort of a form of brainstorming, and just to get your thoughts and ideas onto the page. So there's no structure with this. You can write any style, any form. You might be inspired to write a poem, or you could even do a list. A list of details is a great way to brainstorm for a future piece of writing. The idea is to keep the pen or pencil moving as much as possible. It's very freeing to do this, and to not get caught up on grammar, spelling, or punctuation. So a lot of times people, you know, they feel that they just have to articulate everything just right, and getting caught up on grammar and spelling and punctuation really detracts from the thoughts and ideas. And later on, we can correct and polish and edit, proofread. Those things can be done later, but not during free writing. So I encourage everybody to do this on paper. There's something freeing about doing it on paper rather than the computer. It's more of a stream of consciousness. It's like journaling. So if you really want to use the computer, of course, that's up to you. But there's definitely something more technical and more structured when you are free writing on the computer. It just makes more sense to do it on paper. So if everybody could grab a piece of paper and a pen or pencil, or if you must do it on the computer, if you don't have access to be able to handwrite it, then go ahead and get a document open on your computer. I'll give everyone a minute to do that. So sometimes with free writing, I will just say to my students, go ahead and write. Free write on anything. And they'll write whatever's on their mind, or they could write about what they did over the weekend or whatever. And then sometimes I give a topic or a choice of topics. And then within the topic, it's open. So again, there's no structure that has to be followed. We're not paying attention to grammar and those things in free writing. So please, while you're doing this, don't censor yourself. Just allow it to come out and onto the page. So let's see, here are the options. The first one would be to write about a powerful, or it could be your most powerful, experience in the animal rights movement. It could be bearing witness, taking part in a rescue, a mass action, civil disobedience. So anything that stands out to you as being powerful and as an activist. The second option would be your thoughts and feelings as an animal rights activist. So this would be more personal expression, how you feel as an activist participating in animal rights activism. And the third option is animal rights as a social justice movement, which would be a more objective option. It might be more philosophical or analytical. So, and of course you can write on any other topic, but it would be good if you wrote on something connected to animal rights, to activism, for the purpose of today. So go ahead and take 30 seconds to decide which option. And Sally Zito is going to play some instrumental music in the background while we write. Instrumental music is often a great way to stimulate creativity. So I'll take my screen share off so that you can bring Sally on. And hopefully everybody has been able to see the options or choose to write about anything you want that's related to animal rights and activism. So we've got a little less than a minute, and so Sally will be wrapping it up. And everybody just write for a little less than a minute. Hey, thank you, Sally. Thank you. That was beautiful. So I noticed the time, and initially we were going to open it up to allow a few people to share. If you want to put in the chat how you felt about doing this exercise, whether you were inspired or whether you learned something through doing this, I'd love to see comments in the chat. And we were going to let a few people share verbally either how the exercise was for you or actually sharing the piece of writing or part of what you wrote. But I'm not sure that we will have time for that. I do want to say that I noticed in the chat about computers, somebody mentioned, my only thought on that was just that free writing by hand tends to be more like journaling, and it can really sort of allow us to disconnect from the computer. But certainly doing it on the computer is fine. It's just when I do this free writing exercise with my students, we are writing on paper. And so I hope everybody enjoyed doing this, and I encourage you to do free writing at any time. You never know, it might be the start of a poem or an article or a personal essay, and I'm appreciative for the opportunity to do this. Again, if you have the opportunity to check out my book, Voices for Animal Liberation, online, it's available to order. And thank you so much to Joanna and Aiden for this opportunity.
Thanks so much, Brittany, for sharing that with us and for reminding us and inspiring us all that we need to utilize all the kind of means that are available to us. And yeah, thanks to everyone also for participating. It was really cool to just scroll through and see everyone kind of like writing in the little thumbnails. All right, well, we have come to the end of our call here for today. I think a lot of you have been on previous calls, so you kind of know, at the end that we kind of do a few closing announcements. So thanks to you all so much for being here today. I know this is kind of a challenging time, and it's just really inspirational to see how many of you continue to join us on these calls and take action. And, you know, you're all kind of proving that we need to continue doing this work. This is a time where the world really needs political and social change more than ever and needs action more than ever. And that's why we're committed to being here and doing this, even in the face of a crisis. And this work that we do needs funds to keep it going. To help us continue doing open rescue, exposing factory farms, putting on free events like this one, and providing open source materials to people around the world so that we can empower more people in this movement. And so if you're in a position to contribute, we are looking for new monthly donors, and any donation helps, even if it's a few dollars. We really appreciate any support that people can give. So you can go to the link on the slide here, and we know that many people are experiencing financial hardship right now. And so, you know, if you're unable to support our work financially, just know that you being here and being a part of this community is appreciated and loved. So what we have upcoming for this next week, Lewis mentioned earlier, on Tuesday, we're going to hear from them and Rachel about civil disobedience, why it's a powerful tactic that can help us to create social change, and things we need to know, like knowing our rights and what to do if we get arrested. And then on Thursday, we have a workshop called The Revolution Will Be Facilitated. And I'm actually going to be talking about the organizing strategy behind facilitation. So why facilitation helps to lead teams to better results. And I'll share some tips and tricks that you can use when you're facilitating conversations, whether it's meetings of activists or, you know, even just family conversations. And you can register for any of those trainings at the link on the slide here. And if you have any questions or feedback, you can also email us at info@liberationconference.com. And also let us know what we should do next. We're starting to think of, you know, next weekend is our final weekend, and we're starting to think what comes next. And so we want to hear from you what you've appreciated about these calls, what you want more of. So send us an email and let us know what you think. And next Saturday is the final Animal Liberation Online Assembly. So we're going to meet back here at 1 p.m. Pacific time, and we'll all get to be part of the first, we think this is the first, online open rescue. So this is an internationally coordinated action, and we want to make next weekend our biggest call yet. So we need all of you to bring your friends, family members, people in your communities. And what, you know, a lot of people, I think, on this call, many of us, I'm sure, have been transformed after being a part of Open Rescue. And so being able to do this online is actually an opportunity for us to make more people be a part of Open Rescue who normally wouldn't, who wouldn't be able to experience it. So this is really an opportunity for people who, you know, they're not going to come to an action at a farm, or they're not going to come to a slaughterhouse. They can join this Zoom call and they can experience that transformational power of being a part of Open Rescue. So definitely join us next weekend and let everyone you know that this is something they can be a part of. And I just wanted to also take a moment to express gratitude again to all of you for joining us, of course. And thank you so much to everyone who spoke today. Renee, Brittany, Zoe, Lewis, everyone else, the musicians. And a huge thank you as well to Amanda, our ASL interpreter, and our Spanish translator for today, Camilla. And yeah, that's it for today. So, you know, we've been ending these calls with something called the Unity Clap. And this is something that we've borrowed from the United Farm Workers Movement. And it's something that they did at the end of each day to feel solidarity with each other. Many of the members didn't speak the same language, and they would be separated by really far distances in the field. And so they would do this clap at the end of the day to feel solidarity and remember that they stood amongst all these other people. So if you want to put your Zoom on gallery view, you can see all the thumbnails of everyone. And the clap starts off slow, and then it gets faster and faster, like a heartbeat. And then it ends with one final clap. So we're going to unmute everyone now so that we can hear each other clapping. And once the clap is over, that will be the end of the call. So thank you all so much for being here. And I look forward to seeing you all next weekend.
Cool eyes. Thank you. So funny. Because you could see everybody's like faces pop up on the screen. Yeah.